When you're thinking about, you know, making it into the league, you get in the league now. You know, they have that rookie symposium, right? And we're going to educate you. Let's dial this when it comes to finances. You start to make a little bit of money now. You know, you got even more attractive. You got the ladies. You got the clubs. You got all these things going on. How would you start handling your finances? What would be your first few moves when somebody starts getting some money?
Yeah, so it's like you got to think about it. But like for me, I have such a good team around me, and I built this team over the last 10 years. I built this team. I've been out of the league for 8 years, so even a long ways into my time in the league, I didn't have this team and this education around me. And the more money you have, the better resources and the better people you have around you, but also a lot of things pulling from you. But oddly enough, I think probably the most important thing is, because nothing's guaranteed, right? So you sign this deal, you go to the NFL, you're 22 years old, and say you have a $5 million contract, of which $2 million is guaranteed, but you're going to make the next $3 million over the next 4 years. Like, what should you do? Honestly, I think you should probably get a life insurance policy. Something safe, something secure. In the event that you're not here anymore, your family's going to be taken care of. Like, I didn't have kids till I was 27, so it's kind of hard to see that vision. But the great thing about the life insurance policy is the younger you are, the cheaper it is, right?
Yep.
So the younger you get a nice life insurance policy, and then you're, you know, putting that money into that life insurance policy, and it's building up its cash value, and then you can leverage that at some point. I think that's probably the safest, best way to start things out.
By the way, full disclosure, Brendon's not my client. He's not my client. He's not one of the clients or agents. He's just doing this from wisdom he's learned from his time in the league and dealing with finances. What exposed your reality? Because oftentimes, especially coming from the hood, people think that life insurance is just for when you die. When were you exposed to the money-making, the living benefits of life insurance? When were you exposed to that education?
Yeah, so, I mean, I got my first, you know, we have, my first whole life policy I didn't get till I was probably 27 when I had a child. But that's around the time I was exposed to it, because I'm like, all right, you know, what am I going to do, you know, in the event that something happens to me? And then you have, you know, kind of like that annual policy that the NFL gets for you.
Yeah.
And, you know, in the event that something happens, but, you know, they're renewing that every single year. So that's a little bit different. So it took me a little while. It took me till I was 27 to learn about, you know, the benefits of using your life insurance and accruing that cash value. And now, like, I use it all the time. You know,
wow.
What I'm saying? Like, I started my business. I have 50 Orange Theory Fitness franchises.
Wow.
Across the United States and in Melbourne, Australia. I took the money to put my down payment on my first Orange Theory. I took it out of my life insurance policy, and I used that money. So really, you know, at 27 is when I started buying into that. And then from there, I got every one of my kids a policy. Now I have several policies. My wife has a policy. So between my whole family, like, we have 8 policies, whole life insurance policies in this house. It's something I firmly believe in, but it's also given me the foundation, the confidence, the balance in the way that I balance my portfolio. But for a young player, the sooner you get life insurance. And then that's one thing you know, like you mentioned, from the hood, it's something we're not exposed to.
Yep.
That's the way that families continually pass on wealth.
Boom.
It's through life insurance.
Hello.
And generational wealth, you know? So
yep.
My kids are going to be good. Like, I don't need to leave them a cent. If I die, like, I can spend all my money right now. And if I die tomorrow, and I want to live a good life too. And that's what I love about you, is that you're smart with your money, but you want to live a good life as well. You have a certain type of lifestyle that you want to live. And like, I'm not trying to save every single nickel, every single penny that I have. And why don't I have to do that? Because the second something happens to me, my life insurance kicks in, and there'll
yeah.
be plenty of tax-free money, you know, that's being handed down to my kids.
So you were in the league for a minute. You were making professional income. You have an agent behind you. How did you find your agent? I mean, how did you find your life, not your sports agent, but how did you get exposed to a life insurance agent to start explaining this stuff to you?
Yeah, so, you know, I was lucky just because through my financial advisor, he's got a life insurance company built into it.
Good.
And it just worked that way. And then from there, we kind of started adding pieces and changing my portfolio. And I could do different things based on what my life insurance was doing.
Yeah, gotcha.
So I didn't want to hold, you know, a lot of financial advisors are really conservative with the way that they're investing, and the world is changing right now. So, you know, as the world started changing and as my risk profile started changing, I'm like, well, I have this life insurance that's guaranteed and I have bonds that are backing it and so on and so forth. Like, I don't need to keep investing my money in bonds. I can put my money in riskier things, and I can let my life insurance be my very conservative part of my portfolio.
You save money.
And it's acting in the way that it needs to act. So this has grown and this has changed. You know, initially, as I started learning about the life insurance, we had a more conservative portfolio, and I knew I had, you know, income coming in through the NFL. So that kind of changed our strategy. But as I got older and things changed, and then I started coming into a lot more money, then it's like, for a minute, I outgrew my life insurance. I'm like, I have these life insurance policies. I don't need them, you know? Yeah. Of course, there's going to be a great, you know, tax-free benefit to whoever's here after me, but I don't need them. Then we had to restructure and re-strategize. And then I started learning about premium life and premium funded and premium finance insurance, which is a whole different monster that I've been exposed to in the last year, which I love. And they're super exciting. And it made, you know, life insurance, it refreshed it for me and it made it sexy again. But yeah, it's always, and there's always new products that come online as well. So I think it's always a learning opportunity for me to learn about life insurance and all the amazing things that it can do. And also something as of late we're looking into is as you come into liquidity events, as you come into, you know, opportunities where you're making a lot of money, you can buy policies in advance that can save you and shelter your taxes. When you get these, you know, huge liquidity events, you can buy policies that will make it so they mitigate your tax liability on the front end. So we're doing some of that stuff. I mean, there's so many cool things that you can do with life insurance, and it's fun to talk about, but you don't really see, you don't have, it's hard to have access to people that have knowledge and use the insurance policies the right way.
I think the only exposure to a lot of athletes was when Jim Harbaugh became a coach at Michigan. And he asked that, I think it was like $5 or $10 million be reallocated to his life insurance policy.
Right.
It was what they call a split dollar arrangement. So if I stay here, a portion of my salary, even though you tax me on that income, is going to go to my life insurance policy because I want that growing. And now he's got a new contract with Michigan. So it's interesting how when you break down what the wealthy do, sure they maximize their 401k, but there's only a certain amount of money you can put inside the 401k. But you know, six figures, some guys even seven figures, are going into a life insurance contract. And so that's where the misconception of it's only for when you die or a certain amount of money. So yeah, you're a financial advisor. So I'm just curious, this is the help out our community, because sometimes our financial professionals don't know how to access clientele like yourself. So how did you find your financial advisor?
So I had a friend that was playing in Tampa at the time.
Gotcha.
And he was his financial advisor. And then I just took a meeting and I met with several advisors. And, you know, it's like dating, you know what I'm saying? So I went and I dated one, I went and dated another. And, you know, eventually I found one, you know, that worked for me. And it's kind of funny because I was talking to him last night. And I'm not going to say his name, but he just did. He had to get out of all the financial advising because his business took off that he was doing on the side, and he just did a $70 million deal through cryptocurrency and Bitcoin and whatnot. And so we were just, you know, shooting it up last night talking about crypto, and he sends me this little screenshot of his bank, one of his bank accounts had $70 million in cryptocurrency.
That's so cool.
I'm like, damn, dog, you're balling. But it's funny that he was my advisor and, you know, he still, you know, is a fiduciary for me.
Correct.
But I think the tough thing is to have that circle of people that you trust and that they're in it for you. They're not in it to make money. You know what I'm saying? That's why I love that you take your whole team with you and I see your team around you and you're trying to educate people and be like, hey, if you want to live a certain lifestyle, these are the things you have to do. And millionaires run with millionaires and billionaires run with billionaires and broke people run with broke people. So it's like, who's in your circle? Who's around you? And I've been so lucky, like coming from the projects of Chicago, a single mom with three kids, to be living where I'm living. Like I live in Brentwood, Los Angeles right now. Like Kobe lived in this neighborhood when he was with his first contract with the Lakers. But like LeBron lives down the street and Draymond lives down the hill. Like it's a great neighborhood. Kamala Harris lives in the neighborhood too, talking about, you know, vice president. But
nice.
I've been so blessed and fortunate to come from my humble beginnings and background and to be in the position that I am now. And I just want to be able to continue to lock that in. Yeah. We're always honing, we're always refining, and then to be able to pass that on to my kids, and then my kids carry on the legacy as well.
That's so awesome, man. So it's word of mouth. You didn't answer a direct mail piece in the mail, even though there's a list with the NFLPA. You could be an advisor on the list. You can be part of the part of the approved list that goes to the background check, pays $5,000 a year, be part of the financial advisory list, the real estate list, the insurance list. But for you, it's still word of mouth. You found word of mouth. Yeah. Okay, people that you trust. You talk about building this team, Brendon. Let me ask you this question. What's some of the check marks? What's some of the filters that you mentally go through to say this person deserves to be on my team? Is it influence? Is it trustworthiness? Is it character? What's some of the markers you go through?
Yeah, like I think there's certain things that are unknown, but you have to spend a certain amount of time with people, you know?
Okay.
People can fool you. People can trick you. I've been fooled. I've been tricked. You know what I'm saying? But you have to spend a certain amount of time with people, but you have to like look inside yourself first. Like, okay, what is it that I need? What am I proficient at? You know, what are my weaknesses? What are my strengths? Where do I need help? You know, and for me, as I started, you know, escalating through kind of that financial ladder and getting to a certain type of net worth, then different people were coming towards me, and I knew at certain times I needed those people, and at certain times I wasn't ready for those people yet. So, you know, as I started to educate myself, my standards got higher. What I needed was more complex and more complicated. Like I have a tax attorney now, you know, I have a venture capital group that I belong to that takes me along and they teach me different things about investing, and we'll go see different companies and so on and so forth. I have my tax advisor. I have my insurance guy that does kind of everything but life insurance. Then I have my guy that does my life insurance, which is different. You know, my other guy does like my house, cars, balloons and things like that. So over the years, I built this team around me based off of what I needed and where I was lacking, and having these people fill in the gaps. And it takes time because, you know, I'm always trying to evolve and change. I'm not trying to stay the same. And those people may come in or come out of your life. So I think the most important thing is I built my team, and the team, even though they're not all on the same team, they're all on my team, and they all work with each other, and they all kind of check and balance each other. So if I do a phone call for, you know, this huge life insurance policy that I'm working on, my tax attorney's on it, my accountant's on it, and then my fiduciary's on it, and then my insurance policy guy is on it, and then I'm on it. So we have five people on the phone call making sure that everything checks all the squares, all the boxes, and there's questions that I might not know that my financial advisor asks. There's different, you know, things that might kick in on how we need to structure this thing that my accountant will ask. So I get everybody in the room, and it's a Zoom call. And, you know, we hash all these things out, and we figure out like, hey, what's for Brendon? Everybody's on there on that phone call to do what's best for me. And you just have to have those people in your life that they're trying to do it for you. And I think I've been lucky that all my people, they love their jobs, and they do their jobs because they want to help people, not because they want to make money. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, for sure.
Like, why do you have your whole team? Why are you building this whole thing out with education and people and all the different things that you're doing? Like, you could do this by yourself, and you could get rich by yourself if you wanted to, but you're trying to take the whole tribe along with you. So that's what I love about my team, is that like they understand like, hey, what's best for Brendon? And, you know, yeah, I might make some money if Brendon does certain things, but that's not why they're there. They're ultimately there to help people.
That's awesome. It takes time to get to know people. We'll be right back.